For the past 11 years, the Kresge Arts in Detroit initiative has recognized an eminent artist based on their professional achievements, contributions to culture, and dedication to the city. Kresge also presents a group of artists with fellowships that include $25,000 and a year of professional support. I am really pleased to have two of this year's honorees as my guests. Dr. Gloria House is the 2019 Kresge Eminent Artist. She is a poet, educator, and human rights activist. And Nandi Comer is among this year's Kresge Fellows. She is a poet and an essayist. Welcome both of you to American Black Journal.
Thank you. Thank
and
you.
Also, congratulations.
Thank
this
you.
Is like a yeah. huge,
Thank you. Thank
this
you.
Is a huge honor for both of you. Dr. House, let's talk, you've been a guest on the show before, but let's talk about your work and this tremendous honor for your work. How did you come to decide that this is what you wanted to do with your life?
I think it was a sort of gradual decision in the early 60s as I was watching the civil rights movement evolving in the South and becoming aware of the brutalities, the atrocities, and feeling, oh, I want to be involved in making change. Mm-hmm. It's not enough to just watch those things and say, oh, that's awful. But feeling I wanted to be involved. I wanted to be among people who were working to create change.
Yeah.
And that started when I was a graduate student at Berkeley. And I found a way to make my way south, finally. A group of students from San Francisco State were organizing a book drive, raising money to go set up a freedom school in Selma. And I heard about that, and I joined them and said, yeah, I want to do this too.
Wow.
And we went down to Selma. We did set up a freedom school right in the area of Brown Chapel, which was the center of the movement work at the time. And then everything started there.
Yeah. So how did you come to poetry, or how did poetry come to you?
I had been writing poetry since I was a little girl, or trying to write poetry since I was a little girl. I was excited by it. You know, we read all of those classics and. You know, I loved the rhythms, and I loved the idea of metaphor, and I love, you know, making images or whatever. And I had the encouragement of my teachers. Yeah, try this.
Yeah.
Go ahead. Try to do that. And I tried to write little plays. But I didn't ever think of myself as a poet. It was just something that I liked to do. And over the years, I would just put my little things away, and, you know, and accumulate it. So by the time I was in undergrad and grad school, I had a little collection of poems, right? But I didn't share them with anybody
or
talk about them
or
say I want to be a poet or anything like that, right? I was just making poetry, right? So it wasn't until much later I met Dudley Randall. I was here in Detroit. I had settled here in Detroit. And I'd been working with Dudley in a series where we brought in poets from everywhere to read and do workshops. And one day, Dudley came by and said, Aneb, I know you must write poetry now. I know you must write poetry. Don't you write poetry?
Don't you do that, right?
And let me see what you've written, right? And so I brought him down this little, you know, weathered folder of poems.
Wow.
And so that's, so Dudley took that folder. And the next time I saw the folder and Dudley, he had a proof.
Is that right?
Of my first book.
As a book. Oh,
yes.
Wow.
And said, here's a proof, Aneb. I want you to seek over it and see. Do you agree that it should be published? Do I agree
my
that
goodness.
It should be published?
Of course I do.
Of course. Thank you, Dudley.
Wow.
Thank you.
That is quite a story.
Mm-hmm. It was wonderful.
Yeah.
It was wonderful.
Yeah. Nandi, what about you? What brought you to this?
Well, I started writing poetry when I was in high school. I was, I will say that I always wrote little stories and snippets of things all the way from elementary. But I had when I first attended Communication and Media Arts High School, I studied under Terry Blackhawk, who founded Inside Out Literary Arts Project.
Yes.
So I was a part of the first three schools that became that organization.
Wow.
But when I went to CMA, I was convinced that I was going to be a scientist.
Is that right?
Yes.
You're kind of at the wrong school for that.
But I loved, I mean, I still excelled in math and science, even though I was there. But Terry brought me off to the side after one English class and said, I'm starting a creative writing class. Would you like to join it? And after that, it was kind of like this thing that I always participated in, even though I was still going to, science and math, programming, and I still really enjoy a good math problem.
Yeah.
But I kind of see poetry like that.
I was going to say, there's some similarity there.
Yeah,
right?
That's right. But when she finally started to teach us about how to put together a publication, how to put together a school anthology, I really got interested in what it meant to like have collaborative voices in one unit, in mm-hmm. one thing. Mm-hmm. And so I think even when I went on to undergrad and I majored in Spanish and English and I still wasn't a publishing poet, I just, between high school and my mid-20s, I actually didn't have a mentor. And so I would still write these poems, but I wasn't publishing them anywhere. I didn't know much about how to publish them. And so I went off to teach, because that's what you did if you had an English and mm-hmm. Spanish degree. Mm-hmm. But then I had a poet, Vivie Francis, who is also a Kresge Award winner. She decided to mentor several poets in the Detroit area, all of us Black poets who had not had traditional MFA kind of training.
Yeah.
And she taught us about the professionalization of being a poet. And that's how I entered into that world of what it meant to publish a poem, what it meant to put a book out there.
Sure.
If it weren't for that group, I probably would still have my notebooks tucked away somewhere.
Wow. So that, I mean, there's some similarity in these stories, that sort of solitary away, work, right? Mm-hmm. That then somebody else kind of encourages mm-hmm. you to share. Mm-hmm. And I think that kind of captures also one of the dilemmas that all, I think, writers have, which is that the work is so solitary, but that your hope for the work is so social and public that, mm-hmm. that ultimately you're doing it, or you start to do it, mm-hmm. to try to have an effect on mm-hmm. other people. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But you're never sure.
You are never sure, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's always a conversation between the individual work and then how the work is received by the audience,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And sometimes it's just the individual work and you just knowing that there's an audience there, you just have to find out who is there mm-hmm. listening,
yeah.
you know,
mm-hmm.
and that takes a while as well.
Mm-hmm. And the other surprising thing is to when the work is finally out and you discover, it's saying a zillion different things.
That I didn't necessarily intend, right?
Yes, I didn't necessarily intend, but that's interesting. Thank you for interpreting it in that way, right?
It really is
that's
that kind exciting. Of social
yes.
exercise,
yes.
right?
And once it's out there, you know, it's out there, mm-hmm. right? Then it belongs to that community that you've given it to, right?
Yeah.
It's theirs, too.
Yeah. Well, I could not have the two of you here and not have you share your work, so I'm going to have each of you read one of your poems, and Dr. House, you get the first honors here.
All right. I think I'll read from the book that Dudley produced
for me. Yeah.
This first book is a collection of poems that came out of the civil rights movement those years that I spent in Alabama. So I'm going to read the poem entitled Selma, 1965. And it celebrates the role of the children in the civil rights movement, their tenacity, their determination, right, that they were going to be free.
Yeah.
Selma, 1965. Amid the ghosts of civil rights marchers in Selma, in the summer so hot, the children sang in the paths of the afternoon showers. Before I'd be a slave, I'd be buried in my grave. From the Freedom School window, we watched them come across the lawns of the housing project, down the rain-rutted dirt roads, through the puddles waiting cool for their bare feet. touch that dripping bush, break a leaf, and smell the pungency of green. These children were tattered angels of hope, plaits caught at an odd angle and standing indignantly, a ripped hem hanging like a train behind them, gray knees poking through denim frames. Dancing the whole trip, they performed their historic drama against the set of their wet brick project homes.
Wow.
Selma, 65.
Wow. Wow. Do you remember writing
that
poem?
Yes, I do. Yeah. I do. I remember sitting in our Freedom School house on St. Anne Street writing that poem.
Wow.
Yes.
Wow. That's beautiful. Nandi?
Well, the poem that I'm going to read, it comes from a collection that is deeply inspired by today's activists as well with the Black Arts, Black Lives Matter movement, which has a deep relationship with the Black Poets Speak Out movement. This poem is the first poem in the collection, Dear Reader. Dear Reader, this is a private conversation. Americana circa all the centuries. Boy lynched at daylight on city canvas or southern back road or blog. Dear Trayvon, look what you started. Torso reclined on pale boulder, head tucked under right elbow, left hand still in coat pocket. Dear reader, please do not read any further. Dear Michael, I try to ignore your face and peace sign, your mother crying next to Trayvon's mother, next to Sean's mother, next to Emmett's ghost. Dear woman in another city pleading, I am ready to mourn you. Death designs my face. Dear reader, I am not talking to you. Dear cell phone, please stay in your pockets, your purse. Do not record, do not post. If there is blood, the artist chose to omit it. Dear sheriff, dear sergeant, dear security guard, and the boy remains transfixed in his last breath. Dear principal, dear counselor, dear parent, dear man, I am passing, my name is. Dear internet, please do not post my slaughter. Dear every man I know, stop, don't move, don't put your hands up, do not stop, remain. Dear unnamed black man killed again and again and again. Dear, are you surprised? Dear reader, no.
Wow. I mean, we could spend 2 days talking about the parallels between those two poems written.
Those two different eras.
Right, 50 some years apart. Wow. Mm-hmm. Well, congratulations to both of you again.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much
for having
being
us.
Here on the show.
Thanks
this was wonderful.